morning song. Though darkness fills the night, it cannot hide the light. Whom shall I fear? You crush the enemy underneath my feet. You are my sword and shield, though troubles near still. Whom shall I fear? I know who goes before me. I know who stands behind. The God of angel armies is always by my side. The one who reigns forever, he is a friend of mine. The God of angel armies is always by my side.
My strength is in your name, for you alone can say. You will deliver me, yours is the victory. Who shall I fear? Who shall I fear?
I know who goes before me. I know who stands behind. The God of angel armies is always by my side. The one who reigns forever, he is a friend of mine. The God of angel armies is always by my side. And nothing formed against me shall stand.
Trust our lives into his hands.
You hold my
tell Him we trust Him. Words.
I believe you're my healer. I believe you are all I need. Oh, yes, you are. I believe you're my portion.
You're going through, nothing is too big for our God.
Nothing is impossible for you. Nothing is impossible. Nothing is impossible for you. You hold my world in your head. Nothing is
He's all we need this morning. Amen. Amen.
Your love is like radiant diamonds bursting inside us. We cannot contain. Your love will surely confound us like blazing wildfire, singing your name. God of mercy, sweet love of mine, I have surrendered to your design. May this offering stretch across the sky. Inside us, cannot contain. Your love will surely confine us like blazing wildfire, singing your name.
Started a series with the first sermon is ISIS, Islam, and the Bible. That's current events, and you can't deny that something's happening. There's a movement across the earth. I heard FBI this week said that ISIS now is a greater worldwide threat than Al-Qaeda ever was. Are you safe? Last Sunday, and by the way, that ISIS video, it must be something interesting about the church's position on that, because more than 500 people have watched that YouTube video of that sermon since it was released. I don't know how many people listened to it on the podcast. Last Sunday, I turned the corner and said, get ready, because not only is this move of darkness and Islam coming across the world, but now the church has become the enemy of the state in some circles because they won't go along with modern progressives. I said, get ready. You better be willing to take a stand on who you are and what you believe. You see, these are relevant current events that the church is needing to deal with. We have a 2,000-year-old story. Actually, we have an eternal story from an eternal God. But is the message relevant today? Today, we focus on a small but powerful four-letter word, safe. Are you? Do you feel safe here today? Would you have come to this group, to this assembly, and sit in this room today if you didn't feel safe? Are you safe when you go to a movie theater? Makes you wonder, doesn't it? If you go to the mall, are you safe? What about a military base or a recruiting station? What about just coming to church? You see, there was a day that we never even crossed our minds that a movie theater would be unsafe or a mall or a church of all places would be unsafe. Are you safe? Do you think God offers His followers safety? You know, I picked this picture as the theme today because I love the view that there are a really big set of hands that hold on to us. Do you think God offers this, spiritually speaking, that His hands cover us? Do we live in an unsafe world? Notice one of God's early promises to His people. And it's found in the book of Leviticus. And the only way I can describe it is He offers people a conditional promise of safety. But He offers safety. Because God acknowledges that we live in an unsafe world and there's an offer of safety. Leviticus 25. Follow my decrees and be careful to obey my laws. Now don't miss the conditions here. Follow my decrees, obey my laws. Follow my decrees, obey my laws. Follow my decrees and obey my laws. Well, that'd be our part, right? What's His part? And you will live safely in the land. What if you didn't follow His decrees? What if you didn't obey His laws? Is it possible that God would remove the safety? He says this, follow my decrees, be careful to obey my laws, and you will live safely in the land. Then the land will yield its fruit, and you'll eat your fill. And you'll live there in safety. That's one of the early promises of God to the people of God. The offer of safety was connected to the words follow and obey. They're still connected to the words follow and obey. Safety is connected to follow and obey. Do you know why? I say it again. We live in an unsafe world, and God has offered safety to His people who will follow Him and who will obey Him. But why? I want you to think about it. Why did God connect safety to following Him and obeying Him? Because the words follow and obey both mean one thing. You're with Him. You see, if God's moving, and Jesus says of His Father, my Father is always at work, and He is at work even unto this day. Jesus says that about His Father. So I want you to picture God is active and He's moving. So when He says follow me, that means that where He's going and what He's doing, we're going with Him. So is it safe not to go with Him as He goes? The concept of follow me is that you're going with Him where He's going. You're doing with Him what He's doing. You're participating with Him as He works. And where do you think the safe place would be? To hang out and let Him leave you as He moves or to follow Him? He says, if you follow me and obey my laws, I'll give you safety. Why? Why? Because in following Him and obeying Him, you are with Him. And with Him is the safest place you will ever be, standing right next to Him. In fact, you want to know how to be safe? Look down every day and see if you're standing right next to Him. When you look down and find that you are some distance away from Him, you have entered an unsafe place. But when you look down and you're standing right up next to Him, you'll find that you're in a very safe and secure location. And it's common sense that you would be with Him by following Him, right? You would be with him by obeying him, right? There is safety with God, not apart from God. Are you safe? The safest place you'll ever be is right next to God. But I realize that it doesn't feel that way sometimes. I realize that as God moves and as God calls and as God plans something, sometimes it doesn't feel safe. You know, he's commissioned every one of us as believers to tell the world about Jesus, but sometimes it doesn't look safe to tell the world about Jesus. Sometimes the world doesn't want to hear about Jesus. But that's his plan, that the world would hear the gospel. Is that safe? This is an unsafe world. Why? Because there's another power at work. His name is Satan. He is not a cartoon character, and let me tell you, he is perhaps one of the highest angels. He has great power. And for a season, and we're living in that season, he has authority. Even Jesus describes him as the prince of this world. His power has a purpose. Everybody listen to me. He is real. He is powerful, and he has a purpose. Jesus revealed his purpose. So you won't have to guess, and you won't be able to say you didn't know. His purpose has been revealed. Kill, steal, destroy. Kill, steal, destroy. So you know. Is that safe? Any three of those sound safe to you? Then who would follow him? He does it through deception. You're not going to follow him into kill, steal, and destroy unless you're deceived. And you look down and find out that the one who could keep you safe is nothing about kill. He's about save. He's life. He doesn't steal. He gives. He doesn't destroy. He creates. And then you look down and you're following the wrong one. Satan is the adversary of God. Interesting to me that the word Satan translates adversary. In the original language. Adversary to whom? Adversary of God. Let me tell you something today. There is no safety in him. There is no safety in Satan. There's no safety near him, in his neighborhood, wandering around his subdivision. There is no safety. Are you safe? He is a liar, and one of his lies is that there is safety in him away from God. His lie is that there's freedom in him away from God. You see, God has these things that you're not supposed to do and things you are supposed to do, and they seem to be limiting your expression of your life. So come on over here and I'll give you some freedom and I'll give you safety. He's a liar. He kills, steals, and destroys. There's no safety in him. He's been speaking that lie since the Garden of Eden. He spoke that lie as Israel came into existence through the covenant promise that God made to a man named Abraham. And if you look at the covenant promise that God made to Abraham, it is a covenant promise, listen, of safety. He promises Abraham safety. Not temporary safety, but eternal safety. It's a covenant of safety in the very presence of God. Because there is no safety outside the presence of God. Satan is a false god who offers a false safety in the very absence of God. And you know what that's called? I've thought about this. You know what it's called? Satan's a false god who offers a false safety in the absence of God, which means that you've removed yourself from the hands of God to have placed yourself in the presence of Satan. Why? Because you refuse to follow God and you refuse to obey God. That leaves you with his adversary, Satan. It's called idolatry. It's called idolatry. It's a substitute. It's you chose someone except God as a substitute. God hates idolatry. Do you know why? What's the first and second commandment? It talks about idolatry. Why does he hate idolatry? Because it's not safe. Idolatry is not safe. It's not safe for you to practice idolatry. Idolatry is taking God's presence and moving it away and placing a substitute in the place where God was supposed to be.
with the idea that the substitute will make you safe, or the substitute will make you free, or the substitute will bring you joy, or the substitute will bring you fulfillment in life. But real safety has been shoved aside. Idolatry is when you take real safety and push it away and put something that's unsafe next to you. It's idolatry. This is an example. I'm going to read to you an example of an unsafe transaction. And as I do, I'm going to do two things. Everybody listen carefully to what I'm about to do. I'm going to ask a question before I read this scripture. Are you safe? And I'm going to look at you individually. I'll add myself to the list. Are you safe? I'm going to describe the conditions of being safe and the consequences of being unsafe by a series of choices. But then I'm going to move from this audience individually, and I'm going to move up to America as a whole. America, are you safe? You see, America likes to think of itself as the only remaining world superpower. How many times have you heard that word, superpower, superpower? Like we have a power beyond anyone else's power. There is a power beyond us. And if you think that we're going to be safe because we have a superpower, then I'm going to tell you the superpower that you're counting on has become an idol. And there is no safeness in idolatry. That the only safeness is standing next to the only superpower, God. So with that said, two questions. America, are you safe? You, individually, sitting in the room, are you safe? Do you want to be safe? Say amen. Amen. Who doesn't want to be safe? You won't be able to say you didn't know. Here we go. Leviticus 26, 23. And if you fail to learn the lesson and continue your hostility toward me. This is God speaking to Israel. By the way, Israel used to be a superpower. If you fail to learn the lesson and continue your hostility toward me. Who's Israel hostile toward? They're hostile toward God. How? Because they refuse to follow him and they refuse to obey him. If you continue your hostility toward me, then I, God, the superpower, I myself will be hostile towards you. That doesn't sound safe. I will personally strike you with calamity seven times over for your sins. That doesn't sound safe. I will send armies against you to carry out the curse of the covenant you have broken. That doesn't sound safe. When you run to your towns for safety, there's the word, I'll send a plague to destroy you there. And you'll be handed over to your enemies, and I'll destroy your food supply so that 10 women will need only one oven to bake bread for their families. They will ration your food by weight, and though you have food to eat, you will not be satisfied. That doesn't sound safe. In spite of all of this, you still refuse to listen and still remain hostile toward me. Then I will give full vent to my hostility. I myself will punish you seven times over for your sins. Then you will eat the flesh of your own sons and daughters. Now I'm going to pause for a moment. If you read history, you will find that when Nebuchadnezzar, when Babylon came and destroyed Jerusalem, 586 BC, the siege against the city was so long and so terrible that food and water was gone that they resorted to eating their own children. Why? Because they thought that their power was sufficient to make them safe. America, do you think your power is sufficient to make you safe in an unsafe world? Do you think your power, ladies and gentlemen, is sufficient to make you safe in an unsafe world? Verse 29. Then you will eat the flesh of your own sons and daughters, and I will destroy your pagan shrines and knock down your places of worship. I will leave your lifeless corpses piled on top of your lifeless idols, and I, the superpower, will despise you. I will make your cities desolate and destroy your places of pagan worship. I will take no pleasure in your offerings that should be a pleasing aroma to me. Will a nation that becomes hostile toward God live in safety? Let's start with America. Has anybody noticed that our nation is increasingly becoming hostile toward God and the Word of God? Jesus has been asked to leave all matters of academia, of politics, of everything. Jesus, we'd like for you to step outside. We'd like for your word to step outside the room. You can have it in church, just don't bring it into the public square. They have become hostile toward God, as if somehow or another that'll make us safe. That'll make us enlightened. That'll make us progressive. Step outside the room, Jesus. Can you be neutral? Well, we're not really hostile. Can you be neutral? There is no neutral. Neutral is hostile. Who doesn't want safety and to live in safety? Who doesn't want a secure life? Who doesn't want to lay down at night and think, we're safe, that ISIS has no application here, we're safe, that we don't have to worry about being Christians, that we're not going to be persecuted in America, we're safe? Who doesn't want to be safe? Everybody wants to be safe. But where does your safety come from? That's not the real question, is it? The question is this: where can I find real and lasting safety? This safety is not an illusion, but a physical and spiritual reality for those who follow and obey God. I'm going to say it again. I'm not talking about an illusion, a feel-good preaching. I'm talking about a spiritual reality that there is absolute promise of God's safety for those who will follow Him and obey Him. Do you believe that? Say amen. This safety is not a denial of evil. Some Christians want to put their heads in the sand. You talk about ISIS and they think, well, that's not real. Well, it is real. Their plan is to run their flag up the flagpole at the White House. I don't know what the future holds, but darkness is coming. Even our own nation now has turned Christianity into the problem, that we need to silence the Christians so that we might find safety in the world. Really? In Psalms chapter 3, this is not a denial of evil, but the recognition of evil and that God has the power to overcome evil. Here's what the psalmist says: I lay down and slept, yet I woke in safety, for the Lord was watching over me. Do you want to lay down tonight knowing that God is covering your house and that you're that one in the picture of those big giant hands? Do you want to lay down tonight? You want that to be your life? He says, I lay down and slept, yet I woke in safety, for the Lord was watching over me. I'm not afraid of 10,000 enemies who surround me on every side. Why? Because I know that the Lord is watching me, and He's already announced why and who He watches over. Those who obey Him and those who follow Him. Is there an enemy all around us? Yes. But I'm not afraid because the Lord is watching over me and He does not sleep. Are you safe? God offers His protection. God offers His safety under the shadow of His wings. If you study the Old Testament, you'll see it time and time and time and time again. This picture that He raises His wings like feathers and He brings us underneath and then pulls the feathers down under the shelter and the shadow of His wings. This is a picture of what it is under the shelter and the shadow of His wings. He's got it. He doesn't sleep. He doesn't take time off. There's no equivalent power. He is the superpower. And if you belong to Him, then He protects us. God offers His protection. God offers His safety. Listen to how God describes His safety toward His people Israel. Deuteronomy 32:10. He, God, found them, Israel, in the desert, in an empty, howling wasteland. He surrounded them and watched over them. He guarded them as He would guard His own eyes. Like an eagle that rouses her chicks and hovers over her young, so He spreads His wings to take them up and carried them safely on His pinions. What a picture. God says, you're mine and I've got you. I'm not only going to protect you where you are, I'm going to deliver you to where you need to be. Do you want shelter and safety under the shadow of God's holy presence? Do you think there is shelter and safety anywhere else? This is the issue of our faith today. It has always been a matter of faith. Do you believe God? Do you follow and obey Him? Listen, here's the issue today. The issue is faith, and the issue of faith is this. Do you believe God enough to follow Him? I'm asking each one individually. Do you believe God? Yes. Do you believe God enough to follow Him? Do you believe God enough to obey Him? Do you believe that God has revealed Himself through the Word of God? If the answer to those are yes, 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 then you understand where safety comes from. If you're questioning in your own heart the answer to those questions, something's wrong. You've created a substitute power in your life that cannot keep you safe. Do you think there's shelter anywhere else? Is it safe? Let me ask you a couple questions. Is it safe to believe God? Let me illustrate. Is it safe to believe God? Is it safe to not believe God? There's the question. You see, we're forced to come to this conclusion. Is it safe to believe this as the Word of God? Okay, option A. Or B, is it safe to not believe this is the Word of God? Is it safe to obey God? Is it safe to not obey God? My grandfather did something many years ago. At the time, I didn't hold it in the value I do today. My grandfather's been gone for several years. I remember sitting underneath a coffee bean tree in the front yard of my granddaddy's house and my grandparents' house. They were both alive at the time, and my grandfather taught me Psalms 91. He taught me from the King James Version. He taught me Psalms 91, and he taught me Psalms 91 under this. Terry, if you want a life that is prosperous and lives under the safety of God, this is it. And he would teach, he had it memorized. My granddaddy had it memorized. He didn't need to open the book. He could just tell me. I want to read that to you today. And I'm asking you a question as I read it. Are you safe? Do you want to be safe? Here we go. I'm going to read it from the New Living Translation. Those who live in the shelter of the Most High, those who live in the shelter of the Most High will find rest in the shadow of the Almighty. This I declare about the Lord. He alone is my refuge, my place of safety. He is my God, and I trust Him. For He will rescue you from every trap and protect you from deadly disease. He will cover you with His feathers. He will shelter you with His wings. His faithful promises are your armor and protection. Do not be afraid of the terrors of the night, nor the arrows that fly in the day. Do not dread the disease that stalks in darkness, nor the disaster that strikes at midday. Though 1,000 fall at your side, though 10,000 are dying all around you, these evils will not touch you. Just open your eyes and see how the wicked are punished. And then verse 9, here we go. Verse 9 is a conditional promise from God. He says, if you make the Lord your refuge. When you say if, that means this condition attached. If you make the Lord your refuge, number one. And number two, if you make the Most High your shelter, if you make God your refuge, if you make God your shelter, no evil will conquer you. You can't lose. No evil will conquer you. No plague will come near your home. For He will order His angels to protect you wherever you go. They will hold you up with their hands so you won't even hurt your foot on a stone. You will trample upon lions and cobras. You'll crush fierce lions and serpents under your feet. The Lord says, I will rescue those who love me. What? What'd you say? I will rescue those who love me. And I will protect those who trust in my name. Are you safe? He says, I'll rescue those who love me. I'll protect those who trust in my name. Are you safe? I want to tell you, there's no safety anywhere else. This is it. When they call on me, I got goosebumps right now. And it's not because it's cold in here. He says, when they call on me, I will answer. He is the creator of this universe. And when you call on him, he will answer. I will be with them in trouble. I will rescue and honor them. I will reward them with a long life and give them my salvation. Somebody say amen. Amen. Do you want to live in safety? Then why is this an issue of faith? I've said this is an issue of faith because the safety that God offers, listen, doesn't always look safe. Everybody listen. If you want to live in safety, he has outlined how to do it. It is an issue of faith. But why is that an issue today? Why is that an issue right now, today, in this church? It's always been the same issue. Because God's calling doesn't always look safe. It doesn't always look safe. That's why it's called faith. Do you believe God? Let me read it again. Verse 14 and 16, Psalm 91. The Lord says, I will rescue. Who's doing what here? I will rescue those who love me. I will protect those who trust in my name. When they call on me, I will answer. Who's I? It's God. I will be with them in trouble. I will rescue. I will reward. Do you believe him? I mean, this is really what it comes down to. Is he talking to me? Is that for me? Or is that only for Old Testament guys? I will reward them. Let me give you an example. Does the calling of God always look safe? Let me paint a picture. Here we go. What about Moses? Moses is having a happy, merry life out in the wilderness, and he sees a burning bush, and everything changes. He encounters God. And the reality is, what did God tell Moses to do? Moses, I want you to walk into Egypt. And by the way, your picture's on the post office wall in Egypt for murder. I want you to walk into Egypt, walk up to the most powerful superpower in the world, Pharaoh, and walk in there, and I want you to tell him to release all his free labor, and in fact, not just release them, give them all a severance package of Egypt's wealth when they leave. Does that look safe to you? You see, the calling of God does not always, in its own perspective, look safe. Do you think to Moses, if you were standing there watching Moses go into Egypt that day, would you say, Moses, that's not safe? What about David? David is just a young shepherd boy, and he's been anointed already at this point by Samuel, and the Bible says the Spirit of God came upon him at a very young age. And he's standing there, and the Philistine army's over here, and giant Goliath is standing down there, and little shepherd boy David. In fact, Saul, the king, tried to put an armor on him to make him safe, and David knew, that's not going to make me safe. I'm already safe because the Spirit of God, I stand next to God. So I'm not going down the hill by myself. God's promised to go with me. And the difference between David and Moses is that they believed God really was there. That's why it's an issue of faith. Moses walked into Egypt because he knew God was walking in with him. David walked down the hill toward Goliath because he knew God was walking down there with him. But if you were standing back watching David, that little cat going down the hill toward the giant, would you say, that's not safe? What about Daniel? This is the story of the Bible. What about Daniel? You know, he prayed at a time when prayer was outlawed. That's not safe. You see, Daniel really respected the government of Babylon until the government of Babylon told him to disrespect God. And then he said, if I have to choose between you and God, I know which one keeps me safe. So I'll keep praying. Was that safe? You see, he did it in front of a window where people could see him and ended up, he's in the lion's den. That's not safe. Or is it? Well, what about those Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego? You know what they did? They in public, the law was that when this certain thing happened, you had to all bow down and worship the statue. And here they are in the open where everybody can see and everybody drops except three guys. Well, that's not safe. Or is it? You see where I'm going? You see, it's an issue of faith because is God with me or not? It's an issue of faith, but do you know what you should do or not? If you know what you should do, then why aren't you doing it? If you're not supposed to be doing it, then why are you doing it? Is God with me or not? See, the only way that I'm safe is if I know that He's with me and I'm following Him and obeying Him. That means I'm standing next to Him and I'm safe. Did that change in the New Testament? Some people read the Old Testament and think, well, that's Old Testament. Yeah, I know. But what about the New Testament? Anything change? You ever hear of Peter and John? You know what they were told? They were called in front of the Sanhedrin Council, the very council that put Jesus to death, that handed him over to the Romans to be crucified. And you know what they told Peter and John? Stop preaching the name Jesus. Stop it. Well, that tells me that if they kill Jesus, they can kill you. And if you say Jesus' name anymore, they're going to kill you. And what'd they do? They couldn't stop preaching. Does that sound safe to you? They couldn't stop preaching. Did that look safe? No, it doesn't look safe. The point of faith is what God calls you to do in itself might not look safe. But is it safe to not do it? Where will you find safety? I'll give you one more, Stephen. He stood in front of the Jewish council and he told them that they had done something. Listen, he's pretty point blank. He didn't use any political correct language. He told the Jewish Sanhedrin council, you have crucified the Savior of the world. You have crucified the Savior of the world. You think that's safe? Who's he saying it to? The same people that put Jesus to death. You have crucified the Savior of the world. That doesn't look safe. And it wasn't safe. Or, listen, or was it? This is where we're going. Or was it? When I look at Moses and I look at Daniel and I look at all these examples, everything they did didn't look safe, or was it? They stoned Stephen. And some of you in the room right now would say, see, I told you that wasn't safe. They stoned him. See? There you go. Or was it safe? Or was it, listen, I'm going to pose a thought. Or was it the absolute safest thing Stephen ever did in his life? Let me read it to you. Acts 7:54. The Jewish leaders were infuriated by Stephen's accusations. What? You have crucified the Savior of the world. And they shook their fist at Stephen in rage. But Stephen, listen, he was full of the Holy Spirit. I can tell you what that means. That means he's standing right next to Jesus. That's what that means. Stephen's full of the Holy Spirit. He gazed steadily into heaven, saw the glory of God, and he saw Jesus. That means he's got to be standing next to Jesus to see Jesus. He sees the glory of God and Jesus standing in the place of honor at God's right hand. And he told them, he won't stop talking about Jesus. He's already got them mad. They're already shaking their fists. Would this be a good time to stop? It'd be safe to stop, right? He can't stop. He told them, look, I see the heavens open and the Son of Man standing in the place of honor at God's right hand. And that made them, they're over the edge now. They put their hands over their ears and they began shouting. They rushed him at him, dragged him out of the city and began to stone him. His accusers took off their coats, laid them at the feet of a young man named Saul. As they stoned him, Stephen prayed, Lord Jesus, receive my spirit. He fell to his knees shouting, Lord, don't charge them with this sin. And with that, he died. Was that safe? You just saw the scene. I hope you visualized it in your mind as I read it to you. Was that safe? Preaching the truth? What if they didn't accept the truth? What if they didn't like the truth? What if the truth made them so mad they'd run for a rock? Should you stop preaching the truth if the Holy Spirit of God told you to preach the truth? Should you stop? Well, that doesn't look safe. Should you stop? Did you notice where Stephen was standing while he was preaching? Listen to me. Did you notice where Stephen was standing while he was preaching? Did you notice where Stephen was standing when the rock started flying? Did you notice? It's in there for a reason. Stephen is standing next to Jesus under the shelter of his wings. Stephen is following and obeying the call of God through the power and presence of the Holy Spirit. Is that safe? Are you safe today? I'm asking, are you safe? Let's look at Stephen. I'm going to repeat verse 55 and 56. Stephen, full of the Holy Spirit, gazed steadily into heaven and saw the glory of God. He saw Jesus standing in the place of honor at God's right hand. And he told them, look, I see the heavens open, the Son of Man standing in the place of honor at God's right hand. Stephen was full of the Holy Spirit, and you can't get that when you're far away from those wings. Stephen was full of the Holy Spirit, which means what? He is standing in the presence of God. Is that safe? I'm going to tell you, there is no other place that is safe. It's not that Stephen had more of the Holy Spirit than those around him. It's that the Holy Spirit had more of Stephen. It had all of him. Stephen hadn't given some of his life to God. Listen, I know a whole lot of believers today that like the idea that you've given some of your life to God, but I'm going to tell you, you're living under some kind of an illusion. Stephen had not given some of his life to God. He had given his life to God, which means if this is the day that God takes it back, then this will be that day. Is that safe? Is it safe? Listen. Is it safe to give your life away? Is it safe to give your life to somebody else? To God? Where do you want to be standing on the last day? Because this was Stephen's last day. This was going to be his last breath on his last day. Where do you want to be standing on your last day? What do you want to be looking at and seeing on your last day? I can tell you what he was looking at and what he was seeing on his last day. And it's not an accident that he was looking at and seeing this on his last day. Because why? Because he was already in the presence of God before he got to that last day. It wasn't something he was running for on the last day. He was already there on the last day. Let me read 56. And he told them, look, I see heavens open. How do you see that? You don't see that if you're far away. I see heavens open, the Son of Man standing in the place of honor at God's right hand. Let me tell you a story. I had the privilege of hearing Dr. Kent Bradley speak at the Operation Christmas Child annual conference in Dallas, Texas this past March. My wife and I went to that conference. Dr. Brantley, some of you will remember, is the first American to contract Ebola. And you might remember the TV video went worldwide when he was the guy in the ambulance in the suit that was being delivered to Atlanta, Georgia for treatment. He was the first person in America ever with Ebola. And now they're bringing him from Africa to America, which makes him the first person in America with Ebola, to Atlanta, Georgia. On July 26, 2014, he became infected with Ebola while working with Samaritan's Purse Hospital in Liberia, West Africa. Samaritan's Purse is a Franklin Graham's organization. He told us in that conference in March that he had received the call of God through the Holy Spirit. Why did he go to Liberia, West Africa? Because God had told him through the Holy Spirit, you have to go to Liberia, West Africa. He's a doctor. And he received the calling to become a medical missionary in Africa. And I'm going to ask you a question. Is that safe? To be a medical missionary in Liberia, West Africa. Let me take it a step further. He told us, listen carefully, don't miss this. He told us in that conference that someone had questioned him before moving to Africa about the logic of him, not just him going, but he decided to take his wife and children with him. And they questioned him about the logic of taking his family with him to West Africa to work in that remote hospital. And they asked him, Is that safe? He said those words. Is that safe? He thought for a moment, and here's what he told us at the conference. I wrote it down. I didn't want to miss it. He said, it's probably much safer than leaving them in the United States where they will more than likely be totally consumed by materialism. I'm going to tell you, that pierced my heart. Because I'm convinced that he gets it. He gets it. You see, the safest place is not always the safest place. You see, he realized that what he would be teaching those children by obeying God and walking with God would be far more safe than leaving them here by disobeying God's calling in his life. The call of Jesus to come follow me does not always look safe, does it? Let's answer that question in reverse. Is it safe to not follow Jesus? You can answer the question all day long about the logic of taking your family to Africa because the Holy Spirit's called you into medical missions. But is it safe to not do it? You better be answering that question at the same time. Is it safe to go? Is it safe to not go? Dr. Brantley became the first person in the world to receive the experimental drug ZMAP and the first person in the world to be treated for Ebola in the United States. Since his remarkable recovery, doctors have done something. They have taken his blood, actually his plasma, and given it to other people. His blood, his plasma, has become the cure to other people who have contracted Ebola. In fact, one of them was somebody, a coworker, that got Ebola after him. He worked with them. They've also been cured. Was that safe? To take his blood? The world would say no. The whole thing. Going there, coming here, bringing Ebola patient to America. Everybody was uproar. Why would you bring that disease into our country? Was that safe? Dr. Brantley said yes. Here's why. Since his recovery, Dr. Brantley has told thousands and hundreds of thousands of people about what it is to live your life under the shelter of God's wings. He has used this platform and prominence to share the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ with the world. He tells everyone that his healing was from God. If you meet this guy, he's amazing. All he wants to talk about is Jesus. He tells everybody that I wasn't healed by ZMAP. I was healed by God, and God used me to now create the cure for others. Not just the cure for right now, but there's a cure to death itself. That's the safe that God offers. He and his wife wrote a book together. Came out, I think, this past Tuesday, where they will share the gospel of Jesus Christ with perhaps millions of people around the world. I'm going to ask you a question. What if he had not gone to Liberia? All of these people would have never known, and they would have never had his blood, which is now the antibody to cure Ebola. What if he had not gone? And by the way, some of you heard this past week, he has gone back to Liberia and started back into that same mission again. Is that safe? What if he had thought it was unsafe to follow and obey the Holy Spirit? Some of you will immediately answer this. I know how you think. Some of you would say, but what if he died? Ask Stephen. Paul died. I've read the book. Paul died. And you know where he was at when he died? Standing next to Jesus. They cut his head off. Is that safe? Peter died. You know where he was at when he died? He was standing next to Jesus. They crucified him upside down. Is that safe? Jim Elliot, a more modern day example, went to preach the gospel message. He was speared to death by the very people he was trying to save. Is that safe? Are you safe? Everybody dies. The illusion is that that's not going to come to you. Everybody dies. Is that safe? Is it safe to die? Leviticus 25:18. Listen, we have this promise of God made available to us. He says, follow my decrees. Be careful to obey my laws, and you will live safely in the land. Then the land will yield its fruit, and you will eat your fill, and you'll live there in safety. I ask you a question. What land? What safety? What fruit? There's something beyond this. There's a promised land way beyond anything we've seen here. And that promised land is available for those who believe God. And He'll take you to the promised land. Because I'm going to tell you what everybody dies. Is that safe? Is it safe to die? I got some good news today. Listen, Jesus goes to a funeral and He makes Him the announcement of all announcements. I guess if you're going to do it at a graveyard. When He looks at Martha and He looks at this world and He says these words, John 11:25, I am the resurrection and the life, and whoever believes in me will live, even if he dies. And whoever lives and believes in me will what? Never die. And I wonder what would happen if the church finally believed Him. That's what I wonder. I wonder what would happen when the church finally believed Him. That whoever believes in Him, whoever lives and believes in Him will never die. Your physical tent might die, but you are not a tent. You are a soul. And your soul will not die. And your soul is going to go somewhere to be with God, where there's going to be a land and there's going to be a safety and there's going to be a fruit. And this time it lasts forever. This is where it starts. Well, do you? Do you believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Messiah, the Savior of the world? That's what Martha said. I believe you are the Christ, the Messiah, the one sent by God. Then you will never die. I'm going to tell you, listen, what I have read to you is the ultimate safe. This is it. You will never die. Even if they crucify you upside down, you will not die. Even if they throw stones at you, you will not die. Even if they cut your head off, you will not die. This is the ultimate safe. There is no safety apart from Him. Do you believe? Are you safe? Every believer receives the Holy Spirit. Let me tell you. You cannot be a believer without the Holy Spirit. You cannot be saved without the Holy Spirit. Every believer receives the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit always comes with two things, purpose and power. You have a purpose, which is the calling, and you have the power to do it, which is the power of God. It's not your idea, it's His idea. It's not your power, it's His power. But if the Holy Spirit comes to your life, you're going to get both. Now, I'm getting personal right now. If you have the Holy Spirit, if you have met Jesus Christ, you have encountered God, you have the purpose and the power of God inside of you. Are you living? I'm asking you, are you living under the power and purpose of the Holy Spirit? And I'm going to ask you, is it safe to do it? And is it safe to not do it? There's only one safe place, and that's under the shelter of His wings, right next to Jesus. As I read this final verse, I'm going to ask you, can you, anybody in this room, find me a safer place than what I'm about to read to you? Here we go. 1 Thessalonians 5:10. Christ died for us. Christ died for us, so whether we're dead or alive, when He returns, we can live with Him forever. This is it. Christ died for me. I'm going to personalize it. Jesus died for Terry Cooper. And He wants you to put your name in this sentence. So whether I'm dead or alive when He comes, I'm going to live with Him forever. I have told you the ultimate safe. Dead or alive, I'm going to live with Him forever. You can't take me out of those hands. Are you safe? You see, the world would tell you that it's not safe to follow Jesus these days. I'm feeling the pressure. I am. I'm getting those funny looks from people. I am. Yeah. You're one of those. Yeah, I am. I'm one of those. You see, the world will say it's really not safe to follow Jesus today. You know what? If ISIS gets around or Islam comes in and they find you talking about Jesus, you know, they're cutting Christians' heads off. Is that safe? I'm going to ask you a question. Is it safe to stop talking about Jesus? You Holy Spirit-filled people? Saying his name will get you in trouble these days. Are you safe? Have you stopped saying his name? Are there some place you won't say his name? I'm watching the American culture become hostile toward God. I'm watching the American culture. You know what? I'm not surprised that the American worldly culture does it, but it cannot happen in the church. The world would tell you it's not safe to deny yourself and follow a 2,000-year-old storybook. That's what they think this is, a 2,000-year-old storybook. And I'm going to tell you what, this 2,000-year-old storybook is being revealed and fulfilled in this generation. And people are going to realize that God wrote the end from the beginning. And we're watching the end unfold right now. It's not safe. I'm going to tell you what's not safe. You know what it says? The world's telling us that you need to distance yourself from this book. This book's controversial. I'm going to tell you, when you distance yourself from this book, you make yourself unsafe. Because this book is the Word of God. It is the person of Christ. His name is the Word. And if you remove yourself from this book, you remove yourself from the only safe person, safe place there is on this planet. You better bring this thing up next to you. Don't apologize for the Word of God. Don't become hostile toward God, because He will become hostile towards you. The world would tell me it's not safe to take up a cross. The world would say it's not safe to bow down and call master a 2,000-year-old person. The world would say it's not safe. What is safe? Follow me. I've often been amazed at the simplicity of two words that changed the world. Jesus looks at Peter, Andrew, James, and John there at the Sea of Galilee and says, follow me. It changed the world. Now, I encountered him and he told me to follow him and it's changed my life. I hope you're one of those people that's encountered this man. He just said two words, follow me. And it just changes everything about who you are. It's wrecked a lot of people's lives in a good way. Totally changes everything. But I ask you, is hearing those two words, follow me, is that safe? Is it safe to follow Jesus? Is it safe to not follow Jesus? I'll tell you a story in closing. It was in my final days at the Hitachi in Harrodsburg. I'd been there 17 years, and I was preparing to quit my job. God was doing His last thing He needed to do to shape my heart for ministry. I was sitting in a park on a picnic table in Harrodsburg, Kentucky, during lunchtime. I can still remember where I was sitting. And I'm reading Psalms 91. And I'm going to read it. I'm going to read it from the New International Version. That's what I read it from that day. And I'm going to tell you, when I read it that day on that picnic table, it was as if God Himself was speaking to me. And I didn't have to guess He was talking to me. Because I was scared to death that what I was about to do, to resign and go into a ministry, was unsafe. I had three kids under the age of 16. I had a 17-year business job. Everything was good. I had a six-figure income, and I'm going to come to a church in Anderson County with 27 people. Are you nuts? I'm going to tell you, if you want to know what does not look safe, that does not look safe. And I'm sitting on the picnic table. And I read what I'm about to read to you. He says this. I'm reading it like He's talking to me. Because He loves me. Because Terry loves me, says the Lord, I will rescue him. I will protect him, for he acknowledges my name. He will call upon me and I will answer him. I will be with him in trouble. I will deliver him and honor him. With long life will I satisfy him and show him my salvation. I believed him. Was it safe? Did it look safe that day? Nope. But I'm going to tell you what, I got 13-year perspective now. It's been 13 years ago since I left there. God is faithful, and this is the greatest adventure I've ever been on in my life. We honor Him. We honor Him. We honor Him. We honor Him. Listen, when the Holy Spirit calls you, He's got a purpose and He's got a power to complete the purpose. And the only safe place that you'll ever find is in the center of that purpose, living out His power. These are the promises of God. And I had that day that I had to decide to believe Him. This is the essence of faith. You have to decide to believe Him. I concluded that day, and I'm sticking to it, that the only safe place there will ever be is in the shadow of His wings. Right up next to Him. Right up next to Him. And I'm going to tell you, I'm going to ask Chad to come out. You know, there's danger in this world. There's ISIS coming over, and they're wanting to kill Christians, and the government now is suppressing the truth and threatening churches, and Christians are being threatened. If you keep the Word of God, you're going to get fined, you're going to get this or that. And I'm going to tell you what, there's a whole lot of fear that makes you maybe want to go to a safe place. And I'm going to tell you today, there's only one safe place. His name is Jesus, and you better be standing up next to Him, and you better hold to the Word of God. Because on the last day, even unto death, the only safe is Him. We're going to sing a song. It's that song He sang earlier, Overwhelmed. We had it at camp last week. I pray today that the power of Jesus Christ will overwhelm you. And you'll find safety under His wings. Let's stand. The invitation's open.
The work of Your hands, the galaxy spinning, oh heavenly dance, oh God, all that You are, so overwhelming. And I hear the sound of Your voice, all at once is a gentle and thundering noise, oh God, all that You are, so overwhelming. And I delight myself in You, captivated by Your beauty. I'm overwhelmed by You. God, I run into Your arms, unashamed. I'm overwhelmed by You. And I know the power of Your cross, forgiven and free, forever You'll be my God. All that You've done, so overwhelming. In You, captivated by Your beauty, I'm overwhelmed by You. God, I run into Your arms, ashamed because of mercy.
Glorious, proclaim it.
You are glorious, You are glorious, oh God, there is no one more glorious. You are glorious, God, You are the most glorious. I delight myself in You, in the glory of Your presence. I'm overwhelmed by You. God, the shame because of mercy. I'm overwhelmed. I'm overwhelmed by you. I delight myself in you. The glory of your presence. Glorious, oh God, there is no one more glorious. You are glorious, God, you are the most glorious.
Death, burial, resurrection.